Hello, everyone, and welcome to The Download, coming to you live from Church Militant headquarters here in the Archdiocese of Detroit. The U.S. bishops are getting themselves in a real bind with the only people that actually care or matter, faithful Catholics. One by one, they are flunking moral tests, and what's more, they're unwilling to see that as a consequence or take responsibility for it. This point is driven home again in the two most recent examples coming to us from Kentucky and New York. In Kentucky, there was a collective rush to judgment by the state's bishops in the case of the Covington Catholic boys, and in New York, a failure to do, not just say, but do what needs to be done in the case of fake Catholic Andrew Cuomo, governor of New York, the abortion and sodomy happy governor of New York. So today, Stephen is going to catch us up on the latest from Kentucky and the ridiculous backpedaling and blame assigning going on there with the bishops. Brad's going to examine the issues surrounding the failure of the bishops to do their duty with regards to Cuomo, the New York bishops, and not just for him, but for faithful Catholics as well. And Simon's going to go all 30,000 feet on us and show us the larger context of what these two latest examples show. And unfortunately, they are just latest examples. Stephen, what's the newest from Kentucky?
Well, the latest. Even as the facts of the incident involving the students of Covington Catholic High School, Native American activist Nathan Phillips, and the Black Hebrew Israelites have emerged, really on the whole, the bishop's response has been quite disappointing. No surprise there, really. For example, take Bishop Roger Foyes of Covington. After initially condemning the Covington boys and apologizing to Phillips, on Wednesday, Bishop Foyes met with students at Covington High School without their parents' knowledge. Now, reportedly, he told the students his earlier denunciation would have to stand until a third-party investigation was complete. In short, unlike many secular journalists, he refused to apologize to the kids. Now, again on Wednesday, the Archdiocese of Baltimore did issue a letter, but it was a rather generic apology. They admitted that they had spoken too hastily, but no specific individuals were mentioned. Not Archbishop William Laurie, no other archdiocesan officials were specifically named as having erred in judgment. Now, incredibly, on Wednesday, Bishop John Stowe of Lexington, Kentucky, piled on even more criticism onto the boys. He issued an open letter saying he was ashamed of the Covington students, suggesting they aren't authentically pro-life just because they happen to be wearing MAGA hats. And so, basically, he said, quote, "I am ashamed that the actions of Kentucky Catholic high school students have become a contradiction of the very reverence for human life that the march is supposed to manifest. As such, I believe that U.S. Catholics must take a look at how our support of the fundamental right to life has become separated from the even more basic truth of the dignity of each human person." That from the
homosexualist bishop.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Stowe is not particularly renowned for his pro-life advocacy, so it's completely hypocritical what he said.
Yeah, he's going to giving a talk at Notre Dame February 1st and 2nd for a New Ways Ministry gathering there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Are they suppressed?
Yeah. They're condemned by the Vatican. He doesn't care. None of these guys care. Yeah. They don't care. They're homosexualists. They want sodomy for everybody all over the place. They don't care. They'll throw dead baby or aborted babies under the bus for it. They'll throw Catholic high school kids under the bus. They don't care. Yeah. They care about one thing: legalizing and normalizing, or canonizing, sodomy. That's all these guys are interested in. Period. Yeah. That's it.
Right. Yeah. And moving from Stowe in Lexington to Archbishop Joseph Kurtz in Louisville, he last weekend issued a condemnation of the Covington students, but on Tuesday he released really just a mealy-mouthed clarification of his position, not an apology. In a blog post, Archbishop Kurtz said, quote, "I do not have jurisdiction in the Diocese of Covington. However, I have sought to act in solidarity with the Bishop of Covington, who is in a position to have the best information about what transpired and who has pledged an independent investigation of the situation. So again, no apology, no retraction, just
I'm just backing up my brother, Rush to Judgment, right. Bishop, because, yep. You know, he's just my brother, Bishop.
Yep, rather than the students he denounced.
I mean, you stop and think for a moment about, you know, they're always going on about we're losing kids, and, you know, you might as well just have, like, pulled out a flamethrower and just shot them all with it.
Yeah.
You know, imagine for a moment any of those kids sitting in that auditorium or wherever the meeting was with Foy,
right.
And he just sat there and essentially said, I don't believe you. That's what he said. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what, you know, I don't believe you. I don't believe you so much.
Tell your side of the story. Don't talk to anybody.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
you can't defend yourself.
Do they honestly think that any of those kids are going to walk out of there unless they've got a very solid, you know, mom and dad in the faith? Any of those kids are going to walk out of there in a year or two and still go to Mass? Yep. Are they out of their minds?
Right.
First of all, a great injustice was done to them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And, you know, one, two, it's doubled down on by all the other bishops in the state. And then three, he goes in and rubs their face in it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. And he didn't call for a third-party investigation when he apologized to Phillips initially.
Yeah, I mean, why couldn't Phillips be lying?
Also, third-party investigation. Who are the two parties? So the two parties are the kids and Phillips. Fundamentally, those are the two parties. You, Bishop,
you're
diocese,
the third party.
You're the third party. Oh, you just don't want to get your hands dirty.
Yeah.
That's what it is. You don't want to come out and have to say, well, we decided that they were innocent, we decided that they were guilty. That's what that is about. Yeah, mm-hmm. This whole, you know, third-party investigation, yeah, make sure that you're not the third party at that point, because that's your job.
Yeah, he's just going to say, I'm shipping it off to the lay review board. Yeah. Shouldn't have ordained the guy to begin with.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
So.
Exactly.
Now,
one bright spot to mention is Bishop Richard Sticca of Knoxville, Tennessee. On Wednesday, he said publicly that the incident wasn't about Covington students in MAGA hats, but bigots verbally attacking March for Life participants. That was a reference to the Black Hebrew Israelites who heckled the boys and other passersby. But really, yeah, on the whole, it's really disgraceful the lack of support for the Covington students when really the entire incident has been filmed. They could issue a judgment right now and should apologize.
Yeah, I mean, you know, Glenn Beck put together it's out on the YouTube or whatever his channel is now. He had his producer sit down and go over every frame of mm-hmm. video from every source that has been shown. Every single thing. Nothing of what Phillips said and claimed is backed up.
Nope.
Not a single thing. NBC said in the interview with Sandman that they scoured through all the video and nowhere did they hear in any of it the build the wall chant. No. NBC said that.
Right.
So, I mean, what exactly is, you know, Bishop Foy investigating here? You know, a larger question is, why is he taking this position? Mm-hmm. Why is he doing this? I mean, why is he so anxious to throw these kids under the bus? Mm-hmm.
Well, he came out originally, snapped judgment, and now he's got to kind of back it up or face a lawsuit. So he's worried about that.
Yeah, well, he should be worried about facing a lawsuit. I'd sue them. I mean, yeah, those all the families of all those kids.
A lawsuit, public.
Sure, they should sue them.
The parents
should sue. They should sue the media. They should sue the bishop.
Well, yeah, I've seen there's a lot of people out there, lawyers, who say that they'll represent the kids pro bono, which I think is obviously very nice because, you know, MAGA hats aren't cheap. You know, you got to buy them. But in addition, on a more serious level, there's been several lawyers, secular and canonical,
yeah,
who have said, you have a case.
Sure you do.
And they have a case in both secular and canonical law against a whole bunch of people. Now, there's a whole discussion. Do you be the big man? Do you, you know, go in and do you do this? But in many cases, these kids' lives have been seriously damaged.
They're getting
these
death threats. Yeah. They have to close down school.
Yeah, suffered genuine harm at
sure
that point.
Sure they have.
You know, so I'm not entirely sure who you sue other than the left in general, which, you know,
well, I mean, you sue any of the media reports, especially any of the early media reports that came out, you go straight to any of the major guys' places, the CNN and all that stuff. You go straight to their Twitter accounts, straight to their stuff, and you pull straight down, here's what they said.
Yep.
You know, we surrounded a guy, we threatened him. Okay, that's a lie.
Yeah.
So
I think you should sue Phillips as well. I think
you sue Phillips
on the basis that, you know, apparently Phillips has had a very difficult life. He's a troubled individual who had an unfortunate childhood. That's kind of the stuff that's coming out right now. So, you know, certainly there's allowances made for that, but you just straight up lied.
Yeah.
And it's not like there was a misunderstanding or there was a miscommunication or both sides. No, you lied about so much. That's so bad. I think the Marine Corps should sue him as well, because he's casting them into disrepute, personally. Mm-hmm. But hey, I'm not a Marine. I wouldn't tell him what to do.
Well, he fought in Vietnam. Oh, wait. No, he didn't.
No, he didn't.
He just was in during the Vietnam years. Quite a difference. Brad, New York has, bishops in New York have their own challenges.
Well, yeah, we have, you know, words cannot describe the lack of response and too little too late by the bishops of America and specifically the bishops of New York. Last Tuesday, they have a signing ceremony, this January 22nd, fake Catholic Andrew Cuomo there signs into law the Reproductive Health Act, which basically greenlights any and all abortions, even after the abortion. If it's a failed abortion, you can kill the kid too. So the umbilical cord doesn't even have to be attached. You know, how about partial birth abortion was too hideous for the country? Well, this is beyond the pale. Now, this was introduced, you got to remember, this was introduced in 2007. Where was Dolan and all the bishops all the way up until 2007? That's what, been something like 12 years in the making here. And we have a quote here, a statement coming out with Dolan at the head of the conference, the New York Catholic Bishops Conference. And it says this: words are insufficient to describe the profound sadness we feel at the contemplated passage of New York State's new proposed abortion policy. We mourn the unborn infants who will lose their lives, and the many mothers and fathers who will suffer remorse and heartbreak as a result, end quote. Nice statement, 5 days before the thing is passed, basically fait accompli. And where is the statement that says we mourn the loss of souls who are going to hell over this thing?
And like and lawmakers who did it.
Who did it. And there was no statement about the loss of souls of the people who kill the unborn, innocent babies. Now,
well, we live in a pluralistic society, Brad, and you can't talk about those things because everybody doesn't agree with it.
I know, but the people that do have the right to express themselves.
Well, there's a question. Do they actually believe that?
So, well, this is the point. And so the point is, a lot of people are calling for the excommunication of Andrew Cuomo, who's a Catholic and who hasn't been excommunicated, as far as anybody can discern. That question really should fall on the desk of this man, Bishop Edward Scharfenberger. By all accounts, a good bishop and in many respects, and he did come out with a critical letter, open letter, towards Cuomo. But there is no, you're going to hell if you continue on this path, and by the way, you're excommunicated because you're in a state of mortal sin, so you publicly repent of this public act of signing into law the death warrant of every unborn baby that anybody wants to kill in the state of New York. Because Cuomo resides and domiciles in Albany and Bishop Scharfenberger is the Bishop of Albany. Now, we have a tweet here by Matthew Schmitz. He's editor of First Things. Also, he's a contributor of Catholic Herald. And he tweeted out this. He says, if we Catholics really believe what we say when we talk about heaven and hell and the dignity of the unborn, Cardinal Dolan, should, after exhausting all their other means of correction, excommunicate Andrew Cuomo. Now, some people are looking at this as a punishment. Some people are saying, well, you know, really being harsh and all this type of stuff. Well, here's two bishops now who actually have it understood. We on the left there, Bishop Richard Sticca of Knoxville, Tennessee. On the right, Bishop Robert Strickland of Tyler, Texas. Yesterday, Bishop Sticca, who on headlines today, we talked about the statement that he was saying enough is enough, basically. He's saying, as we read on headlines, excommunication is not a punishment, and it's to bring a person back to the church. That's a wonderful thing. It's actually reaching out, and Strickland actually said, I stand with Sticca. I basically am backing his statements and what he says and calling for the excommunication of Cuomo. Sticca, though, is true to form, and he's saying, well, I'm glad it's not my problem. I'm glad he's not in my diocese. I don't have any jurisdiction, so, and I'm kind of happy about that. That it's not my problem to deal with, and that's really the laissez-faire, wash your hands, and it's not my problem. I'm personally opposed, but it's not my problem. So you know, at least they're in the right ballpark, and seeing that it's not a punishment for Cuomo so much as the opportunity, a lifeline, the excommunication says, here is a line in the sand. You need to come back across here to have any hope of salvation. Okay, and it's also, of course, saves Catholics from what you might call this cognitive dissonance, otherwise known as being scandalized, into thinking that it's okay to allow abortion. Because if it wasn't, I'm sure the bishops would come out strong and fight it tooth and nail and say people are going to hell over it and excommunicate people. But none of that's happening, so it must be sort of allowed okay in some reason. So I think it must be all right. That's what you're saving the Catholics from.
Sure.
By using that power of excommunication, by using the power of saying, hey, your teaching office, to say that this is something that leads you to hell. You will go to hell if you're killing babies, if you're authorizing that. You got to think about your salvation, whether you're excommunicated or not. You're going to hell if you're doing these things. And that's not happening.
No, it's not. And you know, again, it makes you wonder, we say it all the time, do the majority of the U.S. bishops really still possess supernatural faith?
I think it goes back to what did Salt and Light tell you? Well, Michael, what's the guy's name?
Rosica.
In Rome, go ahead. Yeah. Did you say?
No, he said, you know, if there's anything really good about all these, he called them irregular relationships, but he was talking about gay relationships. That's what the topic was. And he said, you don't see anything, you know, good at all? I said, well, no, not if they go to hell. Father Rosica. And Father Rosica said, oh, Michael, the church doesn't teach that anymore.
That's where I think most bishops are.
Yeah, I really do. Which is a decided lack of supernatural faith. Yeah. I mean, whatever it is you believe, it's not supernatural. It's not being imbued with supernatural grace. It's not happening. And that's why you get that kind of weird... I mean, if a cardinal of the church isn't going to speak up and in the public forum and say what the church says about it, you know, you can have the national right to life, which is non-religious, specifically, come out and say, hey, you're going to, like, ruin all the lives of these mothers and fathers are going to grow up, after the abortion, going to regret it.
That's psychological, sociological.
Yeah, that's all fine. It's true. But a cardinal of the church's role is to say something, you know, with regard to the supernatural.
You're going
to
ruin your life for all eternity.
They never talk about this stuff in terms of the supernatural. It's always political.
Yeah.
It's always political. As though, like, you know, so if we all decided tomorrow that abortion's a horrible thing and America voted 99% to 1 to ban abortion, oh, that would be good because 99% of the people, no, because it's an intrinsic evil. And that 1%, if you still hold to that, you're going to hell. But they never talk like this. I mean, if they're not going to talk about hell, well, who else is going to?
That's scandal.
Yeah, of course it is.
That's scandal. You scandalize the faithful and things.
This is what
no
they don't
supernatural
understand. Too many of these bishops, they have simply gone to so far out there that faithful Catholics never have an expectation that they are ever going to stand up and care as shepherds for the sheep about protecting the souls of the, which is the only thing they're consecrated as bishop for. That's it. So. Simon, take it away.
Yes, so I think, you know, we've got to kind of bring all of this stuff together. We've got these two very recent examples, which in themselves have larger, you know, can be expanded out. So you've got the whole Covington student situation where they were thrown under the bus by their own bishop, by bishops in that state, you know, because obviously, you know, the other ones from Kentucky, thrown under the bus by various Catholics and all of these kind of thing that they were just... immediate knee-jerk reactions. For example, Baltimore, the primal see of the United States, they came out with a condemning statement against these kids, and then they kind of walked it back, but really didn't. But it's like, Baltimore, why? Why are you injecting yourself into this? Nathan Phillips, he's not one of your guys. You know, he's from Omaha. There's reports that he was living on the National Mall, kind of in a homeless state for some time. But that's not your diocese. The kids aren't your flock. Didn't happen in your. Why are you injecting yourself into it? And that whole thing. You just choose to inject yourself into it, and why? And we'll come to that in a second. We have this whole business in New York where the Catholic governor has signed this bill, and there's plenty of Catholic lawmakers have voted for it, and the bishops were silent, and they've got this mealy-mouthed condemnation, but they're not willing to do anything. And all of this reflects, these are symptoms of the problem that really begins with the refusal to protect the vulnerable from predatory clergy, as we saw with the Cardinal McCarrick scandal that broke over the summer now. Last year, they refused to do anything. They didn't speak out against McCarrick. People knew about McCarrick. They didn't stop McCarrick from having access to these vulnerable individuals. They allowed McCarrick to keep being promoted. They suppressed the truth. They lied about it. They did all of this sort of stuff. So what you have is you have this unwillingness to protect the vulnerable. And what is that? It is a symptom of a church in crisis, and it's a symptom of an emasculated episcopacy. That is the problem. When you think about it, the primary masculine virtue is a willingness to sacrifice. It's a willingness to sacrifice for somebody else. And you can do this on various levels. Obviously, you can say, well, I'm a soldier, or I'm a Marine, or I'm an airman, I'm going to go out and I'm going to put my life on the line, I'm going to get shot so somebody else doesn't have to, or so somebody else can have something. Or you can say, you know what, I'm going to be a Marine, but I'm not going to go out and get shot at, but I'm going to put my life on the line, and I'm going to give up the best years of my life to working for a minimum wage job in horrible conditions, you know, and having to live on base housing and this sort of stuff, in order just to do that. You can be a father, you can be a teacher, you can be a priest, but being a priest means to sacrifice oneself, and it means to sacrifice more than just money, more than just time, more than just effort. It's talking about sacrificing human respect. And that's what I want to actually kind of bring this back to here. Why is there such a rush to throw the Covington students under the bus? Because everyone else is throwing the Covington students under the bus. You know, Captain America himself, Chris Evans, threw the Covington students under the bus. And everyone wants to be out there and be like, oh, we're on the, quote, right side of history. We're there
we're
with...
virtue signaling.
Yeah, we're virtue signaling. We're there. So, quickly, we throw them under the bus. Why are we calling for a third-party investigation? Because for us to do it, we've got to get our hands dirty. We've got to get our fingerprints on the investigation. And whichever way that investigation goes, you're going to tick someone off. If you say the Covington kids were innocent and that Phillips was just a shill promoting his race-baiting hatred, then fine. You know what? You ticked off all the leftists. You come down and you say the Covington kids were wrong and that, you know, they essentially just handed this guy a smallpox-infested blanket. That's basically what they did. Suddenly, no, you just upset everyone on the right. You upset all the conservatives. So it's this desperate thing of like, don't want to get my fingerprints on it. I don't want to do it. I don't want to actually make any kind of decision. I want to be, you know, this very, as Brad said, well, I'm personally opposed, but I'm, you know, I understand. While understanding both sides of the thing, I don't particularly want to come down on either one. And that is not masculine. It is not masculine. It is a failure of leadership. And it's not, we occasionally use the word effeminized and stuff. I don't like it. It's emasculated. What it is, it's you have not been made feminine. You know, if you could genuinely make a man feminine, it would be a complete violation of natural law, but he would become a woman. And if he became a woman genuinely, then that would be a miracle of God, and I'm not sure why God would do that, but he would be a woman, and it would be natural to be feminine. But once you just say, I'm just going to take the masculine out of a guy and just suck it out, there's nothing left. You are emasculated. You are a hollow, failed individual. You are not comporting to the virtue. You aren't displaying the virtue that you should display, and more importantly, nothing comes in to fill that up. You are just an empty, hollow vessel making noise. You don't suddenly become filled with gentleness and kindness and tolerance and this sort of stuff. You just have nothing. You just have no defensiveness. You have no protection. You have no virtue of any value when you get emasculated. And this is a serious problem in the Episcopate, and I don't know how we're going to fix it. I think it's all tied up to this homosexual clique and cabal in there. There's probably a bunch of guys out there who are not gay themselves, who may be opposed to homosexuality. They may think it's wrong, but they have lost their masculinity. And in losing their masculinity, they have lost the ability to defend the vulnerable against this evil.
I think that's a very excellent point. It was dialed in for me, what you just said right there. Father Dario Soko said that the homosexual clergy are not warrior-like, they're not Christ-like, in the very sense that they will not defend, they will not stand up. So we have Covington, the innocent Covington students, they're innocent. So there's not going to be a defense of them. You have the unborn in New York. There's no defense of them. You have the vulnerable youth, the young men, actually seminarians in this. Well, there's no defense of them. And there's no defense of the faith. Mm-hmm. So any opposition whatsoever, there's no defense of
souls.
And it's actually exactly what you talked about. It's a symptom of a homosexual clergy. They don't have the wherewithal to be masculine, to sacrifice, in for what purpose? To defend who? The innocent in all of these situations. They can't do it. They don't have that wherewithal. It's broken manhood that won't stand up and defend the innocents at a personal cost to yourself. That's exactly the problem. And how do you fix it? You get rid of the homosexual clergy to get men back in the clergy, because those are the guys that are actually going to defend the innocent and the unborn and the vulnerable and the faith of Holy Mother Church.
Yeah, you think about what's the one of the prime statements of philosophy? You can't give what you don't have.
Exactly.
Yeah. These guys don't have masculinity and what falls from it. So, on one level, they are responding according to their natures. that's what they're fallen nature, yeah. screwed up nature, but that they're doing exactly what you would expect. And this is why all of the stories and various things we do here, you don't even have to get past the headline before, you know, you just maybe some statement from somebody, the communications office has written this or that or everything. We have the same thing here in Detroit. Nothing that is worth defending for the its own good, souls, the faith, the kids, nothing gets defended. And why wouldn't people leave? You know, we think it was yesterday, last night or the night before, an evening prayer in the chapel. It was the letter from St. Peter. You know, shepherds, you know, take care over your flock as a, however, you know, was
watch over it willingly.
Yeah, as a shepherd over the, are you kidding me? That hasn't happened in half a century.
Yeah.
Occasionally here and there, not to, you know, throw every bishop under the bus or something, like they throw everybody who, you know, denies them under the bus, but... you know, this, it's the story of the collapse of the church of the last half century. There are no virtuous men in charge, and this is what you get.
Mm. I think this is an interesting point. Brad quoted Bishop Sticker of Knoxville, and he's like one of the better ones with regard to this, and he spoke out against the whole issue of Cromwell, but you brought it up, Brad. His quote goes on to say, thankfully it's not me. What do you mean, thankfully it's not you? Sorry it's not me. If it were me, I would excommunicate. And are you telling me, really, Bishop Sticker, that there's nobody in Tennessee, there's no Catholic politician in Tennessee who hasn't voted for this kind of stuff?
Yeah.
Where are their excommunications or their letters? Because it's a public matter of record, I'm sure. Where is that? I don't want to, you know, sit there and go, you're a terrible man. You're not a terrible man. You're just not doing enough.
You're just man, not manly.
Well, he did the same thing in Baltimore about Supich with regard to, you know, should guys like McCarrick be excommunicated? Oh, give homosexuals holy communion to homosexuals. Well, no, you shouldn't. Well, Supich believes you should. You're going to go tell him? Well, he never asked me. Yeah, so it's not my problem. It's not my turf.
Yeah. I think there's a beautiful phrase. It's a beautiful phrase.
Can these guys not walk up to each other and have these kinds of conversations?
No.
They won't. Why? Because immediately what sparks from it? Confrontation. Well, okay, so there's confrontation. Yeah. Okay, fine. I mean, you're not going to like pull out knives and stab each other and stuff. Well, maybe some of them should, but they won't.
Yeah.
Again, it's that whole homosexual culture. You'll be violent with each other behind each other's backs, but you will not have the face-off that needs to be had. It needs to be had.
Well, there's a wonderful phrase that I would put to really anyone in these positions, not just the bishops, but priests and fathers and teachers and everyone out there. And it's a great phrase, and it's a wonderful phrase that's really a watchword for a masculine man. It's not my fault. I'm just responsible.
Right.
And it's both senses of the meaning responsible. It means, well, I'm going to take responsibility. I'm going to be a responsible adult. But also, it's like, you know what? This isn't my fault. I didn't cause the problem, and nobody is saying you did, and it's not a thing that you have to take. You know, the fault is yours, but you're going to take responsibility for it. You're going to say, I didn't cause the problem. I'm going to fix it. It's like that, again, the other phrase, you know, it's like, you know, well, Billy started it. I don't care who started it. Who's going to finish it? And it's a very masculine thing to do, to be the one to say, I'm going to finish this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, also in one of your headline stories today was about Mueller, Cardinal Mueller coming out and saying, it's homosexuality and da, da, da. Okay, Cardinal Mueller, you've been at CDF for a while. Is this only just apparent to you now, or is it because the Pope dumped you that now you're like, well, I got nothing to lose. I'm a retired cardinal. I'm done. This is it. So now I can say... Why weren't you saying this stuff earlier?
The retired bishops.
You know, I mean, this just came to you? Really? You're sitting at CDF. You see all these cases, hundreds and hundreds of cases of whacked out priests abusing children, raping seminarians, on and on and on, defrocking them all over the place. And yet now you say something?
Yeah.
Where were your interviews to National Catholic Register 10 years ago? Where were your interviews? Because they're always protecting there's always an angle.
Yeah.
They're always angling for something. And even, okay, what he said is true, and good thing he said it, but again, you've got to go back to the point, you know, on one level, even Archbishop Vigano, I mean, he had a comeback to the side of the angels. He admitted, I have done something wrong here, and I have to clear my conscience. Mueller didn't say that.
No.
Mueller didn't say anything like that. He just, On one level, again, what he said is true, but on one level, Mueller could just be sour grapes. You know, well, you fired me, so I'm going to come out and ratchet out now. It's all a gay thing.
In fairness, I think all of us have been at one point or another in that position of saying, you know, we don't say something. Because it's really easy to say, well, you know, these guys should speak out against this huge, massive thing. Well, did you speak out against some smaller thing in your family? Or were you quiet about your uncle's third marriage? You know, just to have a quiet Thanksgiving dinner so that people didn't throw pies in your face. And we've all been in that situation. I think that it's not to say, well, these people are terrible and we're paragons. No, it's not to say that
at all.
But it's to say that we are all flawed, and this is how you are not flawed, and this is what you display of masculinity. You know, and men can call other men out and say, you know, hey, you should do something. You should change your modus operandi. You know, not my fault, but I am responsible.
Yeah, again, back to Vigano. Vigano, I mean, we can't necessarily reveal how we know this information. Doesn't matter how we know it. That he was devastated after the testimony. I think it was his third testimony. He sent it out and said, you know, look, all you other bishops, you all know this stuff too. You know, you're going to be laying on your deathbed. You know, and what are you going to say? Are you going to tell our Lord that you defended a papal secret or that you actually helped solve this crisis in the church? That was essentially that, you know, you're going to have to face God on this, like I'm going to have to face God on it. Signed, Archbishop Vigano. Not one bishop anywhere on the planet came out and said, yeah, you know what, he's right. And yes, what he's saying is true. Not one. And we have it on very good sources that absolutely flattened him emotionally. That not one bishop anywhere in the world would come out and say, yeah, he's right. Not even back him up.
Yeah.
Just point to the truth of the matter. It's astounding. Church Militant has acquired the reputation, deservedly, of pulling no punches and speaking plainly and directly. There's a tremendous need to blast through all this vague and confusing language so that many in the church leadership, so many of them, use that all these days, and they use it deliberately. Some of them are being deliberately deceptive and wordsmithing in order to conceal a dangerous agenda. Others are simply malformed, going all the way back to their days in seminary in the 1970s, and they've been brought up as little else than managers, not very good ones at that. The last thing the bishops want, because they see it as a threat, which is completely wrong, is for Catholics to be talking like this. But this must go on. Catholics need to know their faith in and out and do what we can to help restore the church on a natural level and a supernatural level. And that means confronting wayward, fearful, or wicked prelates, then so be it. Before we leave you, an appeal for you to become a premium member here at Church Militant, where you can gain access to hundreds of hours of straightforward Catholic programming. That's it for today. Please stay close to Church Militant for the best analysis and breakdown of events and happenings in the church anywhere in the Catholic media world. God love you.